Hello, friends. It's Monday evening, and it's that time again for us to come before the Lord in prayer, to offer up our own thanksgivings, our petitions, our confessions together, as we are all facing numerous trials and have numerous cares and concerns. We need to bring them to the Lord, not carry them in our own strength, and we need to do that for ourselves, for the wider church, and for the wider world. And so let's do that now. And so in this Eastertide, we continue to join with our brother and apostle Paul in declaring these words: thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so now let us come before the Lord and humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. In this time of silence, before we pray together the confession, let us just take stock on our day and throughout these days, the things where we are leaning into fear, leaning away from the Lord, trusting in the things of this world rather than trusting in Him. Let us bring those to mind and bring those to the Lord in confession. Let us pray together. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And apart from your grace, there is no health in us. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare all those who confess their faults. Restore all those who are penitent according to your promises declared to all people in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may now live a godly, righteous, and sober life to the glory of your holy name. Amen. The Almighty and merciful Lord grant you absolution and remission of all your sins, true repentance, amendment of life, and the grace and consolation of his Holy Spirit. Amen. If you'd like to stand, you may, but you don't have to as we begin the invitatory. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Praise the Lord. The Lord's name be praised. Now let us say together the Phoshileron. O gladsome light, pure brightness of the ever-living Father in heaven, O Jesus Christ, holy and blessed, now as we come to the setting of the sun and our eyes behold the vesper light, we sing your praises, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You are worthy at all times to be praised by happy voices, O Son of God, O giver of life, and to be glorified through all the worlds. Our psalms for this evening are Psalms 137 and 138. We will say these responsively by whole verse, or you can read them in unison with me. Psalm 137. By the waters of Babylon we sat down and wept when we remembered you, O Zion. As for our harps, we hung them up upon the trees that are therein. For those who led us away captive required of us a song and melody in our heaviness. Sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in the land of our captivity? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget its skill. If I do not remember you, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I prefer not Jerusalem above my dearest joy. Remember the children of Edom, O Lord, in the day of Jerusalem, how they said, down with it, even to the ground. O daughter of Babylon, wasted with misery, happy shall be the one who rewards you as you have done to us. Blessed shall be, Blessed shall he be who takes your children and throws them against the stones. Psalm 138. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. Even before the gods will I sing praises to you. I will worship toward your holy temple and praise your name because of your loving kindness and truth, for you have magnified your name and your word above all things. When I called upon you, you heard me and gave me increase of strength. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth. They shall sing of the ways of the Lord, that great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord be high, yet he has respect for the lowly. As for the proud, he beholds them from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, yet shall you refresh me. You shall stretch forth your hand upon the furiousness of my enemies, and your right hand shall save me. The Lord shall make good his loving kindness toward me. Your mercy, O Lord, endures forever. Despise not the works of your own hands. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Our lesson for this evening is from the letter of James, the first chapter beginning with the first verse. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes in the dispersion, greetings. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. But let him ask in faith with no doubting. For the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation, and the rich in his humiliation. Because like a flower of the grass, he will pass away. For the sun rises with its scorching heat and withers the grass. Its flower falls and its beauty perishes. So also will the rich man fade away in the midst of his pursuits. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, "I am being tempted by God." For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Know this, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away, and at once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. If anyone thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue but deceives his heart, this person's religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their affliction, and to keep oneself unstained from the world. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I'm not a rock climber, but I've seen some films about it and videos, and so I think I'm at least aware enough to use it as a reference for us as a way to understand some truths in the scriptures. And so I want to just unpack James here and use rock climbing as a metaphor to help us through it. James is often referred to as a works righteousness letter. Some people want to reject it. It was even supposedly something that Martin Luther wanted to kick right out of the canon and called it an epistle of straw. But I don't necessarily agree that this is a works righteousness, a letter, in other words, that says if you do works, then you will gain righteousness and salvation. But I think the better way to regard this letter is as a right working letter. In other words, working in the right way. And what do I mean by that? Well, James, it seems to me, wants his readers to see faith in God, faith in the Lord Jesus, not as a sort of castle that one hides behind and kind of in the midst of a siege just sort of sits still, but only there to starve. But he regards it more as a sort of climber's bag of equipment. The faith is the camelots and the carabiners and the ropes for the climber so that the climber can climb the great walls of this life with all of the various trials that inevitably come. And so what does he say? Well, in verse 2, he first says, for the believer, the faithful one, to meet the trials, to recognize that there are trials and to meet them head on. Through that climbing, kind of going at the rock, then he says strength will come, strength of patience, strength of endurance. He calls it steadfastness. Steadfastness will grow. Again, I'm not a rock climber, but I've watched how these things work. And a camelot or a cam is a piece of equipment that climbers used as they're building a route up a rock. And it, the way it works is it kind of goes into the crevice in the rock, but the only way for it to really work and to be strong is for then it to be pulled back on, to have weight poured onto it, for the climber to actually trust in it, to lean all of his or her weight on it. And as he or she pulls down and puts their weight onto the cam, that actually strengthens the cam and makes it worthy to carry the person, help carry the person as they make their way up the rock. It grips the rock all the stronger by the climber actually leaning on it and putting weight on it, meeting these trials, doing, working, climbing. The steadfastness becomes more profound, greater. Secondly, verses 9 through 10, James makes it clear that the hope of the believer, the hope of the climber, is not in his or her own climbing. It's not in his or her own capacity and strength. His or her own faith is not really where the trust is placed. The trust is placed not in our faith, but in God's faithfulness. James, in verses 9 through 10, reminds the readers of how frail, how fleeting and weak mankind really is. And he makes a vivid image of those who would trust in themselves or trust in the things of this world and how quickly they will just fade away like grass and just be blown to the wind. And so we don't boast in ourselves. We don't trust in ourselves, but we do trust in God. We trust in his faithfulness, and our faith merely is us leaning on his faithfulness. And so the hope is not in our faith, but in his faithfulness. And then thirdly, verse 12, James wants to make clear that the climbing is not just an endless stretch of rock that we just continue to just go day after day after day. Although that's what life can sometimes feel like. He says, no, be assured there is a summit. There's a summit to this climb. If we will be those who continue to climb, we will reach the summit. And importantly, some of you may have seen the film Free Solo, won an Academy Award recently. It's an amazing film, but the climb that James is talking about here, the climb of the faith walk, or faith climb, is not a free solo climb. A free solo climb is one where you don't have anything but yourself. No cams, no ropes. It's just you climbing the wall by yourself. And that's not what this walk of faith is like. We do not climb as free solo climbers. God is with us. God gives us all the gifts that we need along the way. He continues to support us and to care for us even as we climb. And He is the one who gives the ultimate reward at the top. I encourage you, if you're bored and are looking for things to watch, there's some wonderful videos on some of the various streaming services, on Netflix and on Disney Plus and on Prime, about various climbs in Yosemite. And Free Solo is one of them, and there's some other ones about the Dawn Rock is a really good one. Encourage you to watch those. It's an amazing way to understand what this faith walk really is that we're doing. It is a more like a climb up a great face, but trust that God has got that strength going to us if we will lean on that strength of His, and He will give us the summit. He will give us the reward in the end. Amen. And now let us confess our faith in our faithful one, saying together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord, show your mercy upon us. O Lord, guide those who govern us. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. O Lord, save your people. Give peace in our time, O Lord. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten. Create in us clean hearts, O God. Almighty God, you gave your only Son to be for us both a sacrifice for sin and an example of godly living. Give us grace thankfully to receive His inestimable benefits and daily to follow the blessed steps of His most holy life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. O God, the source of all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works, give to your servants that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Keep watch, dear Lord, with those who work or watch or weep this night, and give your angels charge over those who sleep. Tend the sick, Lord Christ. Give rest to the weary. Bless the dying. Soothe the suffering. Pity the afflicted. Shield the joyous. And all for your love's sake. Amen. Most loving Father, you will us to give thanks for all things, to dread nothing but the loss of you, and to cast all our care on the one who cares for us. Preserve us from faithless fears and worldly anxieties, and grant that no clouds of this mortal life may hide from us the light of that love which is immortal, and which you have manifested unto us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I invite you, if you'd like to, press pause and just offer up your own intercessions and thanksgivings. Just pray as you feel led. Amen. And now let us all say together the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Friends, we are so grateful for each and every one of you. We love you. We pray for you constantly. Encourage you to be on the phone, calling one another, caring for one another. If you need anything at all, please contact us so that we can attend to you. We do look forward to the day when we will be back together again. Until then, have a great night. Sleep well. God bless you.